Hachette Audio presents The Afterlife of Stars, written by Joseph Kertes, read by Tristan Morris. Dedicated to the memory of Raoul Wallenberg and Paul Hegedouche, and to the memory of my parents, Hilda and Paul. Beware, O wanderer, the road is walking too. Rainer Maria Rilke. 1. On October 24th, 1956, the day I turned 9.8, my grandmother came to take me out of school in Budapest's 6th district. We were in the middle of reviewing decimal points because of a mistake a classmate named Mary had made. Other parents and grandparents were arriving too with the same aim, although no one had come yet to get Zoli, the boy who sat beside me. My grandmother gripped my hand as we made our way down Andrashy Avenue. At the Octagon, where many of the big avenues of the city met, a crowd had formed. We couldn't get by. A tank stood in the street, a bold red star shining on its flank. There were Russian soldiers, too, but no one paid attention to them. Everyone was gazing up instead at 8 Hungarian soldiers, one hanging from each lamppost around the Octagon. My grandmother pulled hard on my arm, but not before I had joined the lookers. Most of the Hungarian soldiers weren't dead yet. A couple had stuck out their tongues as they dangled. One seemed to be smiling. 4 others wriggled and bucked, but the nearest one to us, straight above my grandmother and me, looked down at us with evergreen eyes, but there was no anger in the eyes, or even light. My grandmother breathed into the crown of my hair, sending hot tendrils down over me.
"Come, please," she whispered, and I shuddered.
The crowd was quiet. Even the few people sobbing were doing it silently, swallowing the sound. From a little way down the street came the sound of an orchestra, and a woman singing a sad song. I looked around until my grandmother turned me toward the music.
"It's a record," she said, "from over there."
We spotted an open window above a lacy cafe a half block away, the white tongue of a curtain flapping out from the window.
"It's Mozart," my grandmother said,
steering me onward.
"His Laudate Dominum, I think. Praise the Lord, it means. Why would anyone play that now?"
"Because they like it," I said.
"Yes, of course, because they like it.
Did you see the man's hair?" I turned back toward the Octagon and the dangling men.
"Whose?"
my grandmother asked me.
"The man with the green eyes."
I knew she had looked with me, but just for a second. The man's auburn hair was parted and brilliantined so that it shone even at this distance.
"Do you think he combed it for someone?"
I asked.
"I don't know," my grandmother said. "His sweetheart, I suppose."
I thought she might cry, but instead she said,
"Now please keep moving, my dear. We'll have cake. Let's have cake at Gerbo."
"Now?"
"Yes, now. Let's have a treat. You can order anything you want. I know you want poppy seed strudel."
She took me all the way to Vereshmarty Square. The cobblestones made me think of a great house lying on its side. From the top of the building opposite, 2 Russian soldiers, both sturdy women, unfurled a canvas sheet so big it covered a side of Kossuth's department store from roof to sidewalk. It was a vast portrait.
"Look, it's Papa Stalin," I said.
I knew him right away from the picture above the clock in our classroom. He had the same smile and mustache, a mustache that was 3 times as impressive as Hitler's, which was little more than a black checkerboard square. I found myself smiling back at the giant face, like a circus face.
"Please,"
my grandmother said, giving my arm a tug.
"The great father forgot himself," she said under her breath. "Forgot to leave. Come, Robert, please.
And she pulled even harder on my arm now. I was as excited about poppy seed strudel as I was about Kaiser Laszlo, Jerbo's monkey in a golden cage. He squealed as soon as we walked in. I think he recognized me because I'd fed him some apple cake last time. If I were the Kaiser, I'd recognize everyone who fed me cake. He was wearing a bellman's blue cap and vest. He tilted his head in an appealing way and held out his little hairy hand. At the table, I felt warm, as if we'd come in out of a storm. The waiter placed our sweets and cocoas in front of us. My grandmother took out her compact and mother-of-pearl makeup case. I watched, dazzled, as like an artist, she applied some lines and clouds, borders and dots. Once done, she fished out her monogrammed silver cigarette case, removed a cigarette from behind the garter, and tapped the end on the case before lighting it. I was just breaking off a corner of my strudel for the Kaiser when the manager walked to the middle of the busy cafe, clapped her hands sharply, and called out to us, saying we all had to go. She was very sorry. The cafe was closing for the rest of the day, but we could take our cake with us. The waiters brought linen napkins in which to wrap up our things. For a moment, I thought it was because they'd run out of cake, but the glass cases were full of colorful sweets. I noticed a colony of marzipan goblins and other figures. Our waiter brought me one of them, a marzipan monkey with a cap like the Kaiser's. A woman in a long mink coat brushed by us, trailing the scent of mothballs. For the longest time, I had thought that this was the scent of mink, until my grandmother explained. The woman paused by the door to glance back at us, but then peered down at her feet. She wore black patent leather shoes with very high heels and sharpened toes. They were pointed at something. "Look," the shoes seemed to be saying, "right there on the floor. Have a gander." Then, with their fine sense of direction, the shoes turned, aimed themselves toward the door, and took the woman out with them. People were leaving quickly and abandoning their cake, most of them. "What will happen to the Kaiser?" I said. "They won't hang Laszlo, will they?"
"No, of course not. Not a thing will happen to him," my grandmother said. "He'll be here for us next time."
"When?"
"Next time," she said,
as if she were saying never. We hurried home to find my parents rushing around the apartment and making telephone calls. My mother flitted from one room to the next. She smiled when she saw that I was home.
"Sorry you had to leave school, my lumpkin," she said,
and then went about her business. My brother Attila was already home. He was 13.7. And he had our mother's blonde hair, while I had black hair like our father's. Attila was also a head taller than I was, everyone kept pointing out. It made me want to plop an extra head on top of mine, a freaky one, possibly. My brother was sitting on the sofa eating an apple.
"They're leaving altogether, my lambkin," he said to me.
I sat down beside him.
"Where are we going?"
He was chomping away, but said,
"West. We're going to the Wild West. You'll need your cowboy hat and spurs."
My brother wasn't saying any more. He acted as if he knew, but wasn't telling. So I said,
"I saw the hanging men."
His face fell open.
"What do you mean?" "From the lampposts."
He turned his arctic blue gaze on me.
"Which ones?"
I crossed my arms.
"On Andrashi," I said, "at the octagon."
I pictured the man with the green eyes and nicely combed hair, but I wanted to protect the secret of this man. So instead, I said,
"Some of the men had their tongues sticking out."
Attila jumped to his feet.
"That is not what happened. You did not see hanging men, and they do not stick out their tongues. I know that for a fact."
I shrugged.
"Ask Mamu."
Attila ran off to get our grandmother, and I could hear him yelling out questions at her. When he came back to me, he had whitened. His blue eyes looked like marbles dropped in snow. I thought he might want to strangle me, He glared, slapped at the arm of the sofa.
Are they still there?
He asked.
What? Are they still hanging there? Shit!
He rushed out to the balcony and climbed onto the railing to peer out over the bronze head of Mor Yokoi, the old Hungarian writer whose statue sat at the top of our street, keeping watch over it. Attila turned toward me with his icy stare. Then he flew back past me to our bedroom, slamming the door behind him. That night, as we got ready for bed, my brother looked inside his pajama bottoms. He did quite a study, then raised his arms, flexed, and faced the mirror, admiring the muscles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.